on developing the pipeline, the talent pipeline of women in STEM professions, with a particular focus on women of color. And there's just been so much success and so much energy around this space. This is the 22nd year of the conference. And about 3 to 4 years ago now, Dr. Tyrone and I had a little heart-to-heart talk. I put a little hometown Detroit influence on it. Was able to bring the conference to Detroit for the first time. We could keep it here. And I have to tell you that the support has been just outstanding. So I thank all of you, because without your support, it would likely have moved on. So thank you. Our young girls who benefit, thank you. So just, this is, I'm not going to talk very long. Those of you who know me know I can talk about this conference. I'm not going to do that today because we have a special agenda. We're starting a speaker series. We really want to be able to reach out and connect with a lot of organizations in the community with whom there is an opportunity for us to sort of leverage our unique initiative. So we want to do that. But again, the Women of Color is an opportunity for organizations to support the development of the talent pipeline. And we do that through a supportive community that provides networking, professional development seminars, award recognition, career fairs, just a host of events that serve to not only benefit the participants who are there, K-12, college level, young professionals, as well as senior professionals, but it serves the employers as well. Employers who see this initiative as a way of enhancing their diversity and inclusion initiatives, as well as their leadership development initiatives inside of their companies. So with that, that kind of brings me to someone who is very special to me, someone who is near and dear to my heart, for a number of reasons, to introduce our speaker for today. And that person is Angela Thompson. She is with Consumers Energy. The first year that we came, this conference came to Detroit, I met with Angela and talked to her about this opportunity. And I have to tell you that she immediately saw the benefits of being a part, being a partner with the Career Communication Group, Women of Color, STEM Conference. So what we'd like to do, Angela, by the way, I should tell you, is the Director of Workforce Diversity and Inclusion, Talent Acquisition, and Leadership Development at Consumers Energy. So she's like all things people within inside of that organization. And I have to tell you, she's done a phenomenal job of getting this initiative spread throughout the organization. So with that, I'd like to bring Angela up to just talk a bit about what her experience and what the consumer experience is with Women of Color has been like.
So good afternoon, everyone. As Monica said, Consumers Energy has been a title sponsor of the conference for the last 2 years. And when we first sat down and talked about the conference and talked about consumers' potential partnership with the conference, there was no way that I could say no. The conference had been extremely excited, not even having participated in the conference, but how Monica explained the conference, the talent that will be available at the conference, and being responsible for recruitment and diversity and inclusion, it was a great opportunity for me to go back to the organization to say, this is a great place for us to be able to attract some wonderful talent to the company. Because when you think of a utility company, people traditionally don't say, when I grow up, I want to go work for the utility company. So we are often in a space where we are fighting for talent with other companies, and we have to go look for them because people are not going online to say, hey, let me see if I can find a job at a utility company. And so it was a great way for us, I thought, for us to brand our company as an employment destination and for us to be able to recruit the great talent that will be participating in the company. And so we talked about it internally, what that participation would look like, and we said, no, let's participate in a big way. And I should probably tell you who was involved in that conversation. It was our CEO, who is a female and an engineer. It was our VP of engineering, who is a female. It was our vice president of human resources, which is a female. And it was myself, obviously female. And so they said, you know, let's participate in a big way. What big meant, you know, we didn't define, which was a great thing because we actually participated in a way beyond, I think, what any of us could imagine. And so what we decided is that we wanted to really show off Consumers Energy to the conference so that people could connect to us and create that excitement for our brand. But little did we know, we took back much more than we could ever anticipate. We definitely got the candidates that we wanted and were looking for, but the conference was over Saturday night. Sunday afternoon, Monday morning, my inbox was flooded from our employees saying, hey, I heard about the conference. Why didn't I get to go? I want to go next year. Put my name on the list. I want to volunteer for next year. Sign me up. And that I hadn't even gotten back to work. Actually, took that Monday off and said, great. But we had so many people. The word has spread so fast about how wonderful this conference was. And the first year, we did not bring a lot of hiring managers to the conference. We were fully staffed with recruiters and with our HR folks, and our hiring managers were like, why didn't you bring me? I want to go. I want to meet those people. And not only were they excited about participating in the career fair, they sat in the seminars and the sessions and stayed at the conference all weekend long. Now, our company headquarters is in Jackson, Michigan. We have a lot of our employees that live on the west side of the state, in Grand Rapids, in Kalamazoo, Battle Creek, Jackson. And so, of course, we had to have a budget around this event, and everybody couldn't go. Everybody couldn't get a hotel room. But for those who couldn't get a hotel room, they commuted back and forth from Grand Rapids, from Kalamazoo, from Jackson, so that they could be here, they could participate, and meet the engineers and STEM professionals from across the company, because the conference was just that great. We had over 70 volunteers for the first year. We had 50 of our employees come and participate in the conference. And then, like I said, after, you know, just a couple of days of the conference, we had those that didn't attend and participate say, sign me up for next year. And so we have all year long people talking about the Women of Color Conference. When is it? Can I go? What can I do? Are we wearing our blue t-shirts again this year? People are really excited about the conference and often forego other conferences that happened earlier in the year because they say, if I can only go to one conference this year, that's the one I want to go to. So it's been very, very satisfying for us in terms of our employee engagement, and then not to mention the talent that we've been able to recruit from the conference. And so we had a lot of our hiring managers think that because it's in Michigan, people are coming from all over the country to this conference. Who would want to relocate to Michigan to work at a utility company? So we know if people are coming to Michigan, the conference is downtown in the building where Ken and GM are, so we know where it can be against them, that, you know, people want to go work at GM. They're excited about GM, not necessarily excited about us. And so what was really awesome is that people connected with our employees, they connected with our brand, and now I was at Tyrone's other conference earlier in the year, the VEA conference, and people recognized us and said, oh, you're the company with the blue t-shirts. Let me come to your booth. And so we're now creating that brand awareness, and people actually want to come and work for us. So it's been a great opportunity for us as a company, for our employees, for the talent that we've recruited. We've been able to retain them, despite our hiring manager saying they don't want to come to Michigan, they're not going to work in Jackson, Michigan. There's a lot going on in the city of Detroit. The millennials want to live in Detroit. But we've been able to actually recruit and retain some good talent for the company, for some actually positions that really we could just post them online and get a lot of qualified candidates. But we've been very intentional about saying, let's see who we can get from the Women of Color Conference to fill these positions. So it's been very rewarding for us. It's been great internally for our employees, and it's something that we're committed to and something that we're invested in. So hopefully you all will be able to get that same experience with your companies and with your employees. So if you need me to come and talk to your leaders about the conference, about the return on the investment, I would be certainly willing to do that for you, because I personally believe in it, but I also see what it's been able to do for our organization. So next I have the pleasure of introducing to you all a phenomenal woman that is going to talk to us this afternoon. Ms. Ida Bird Hill is the president of Uplift Incorporated, a nonprofit tech diversity and inclusion firm where she utilizes her corporate experience in executive search, finance, HR, marketing, and sales to assist corporations develop employee talent. Ida Bird Hill is known as an urban economist, futurist, radical transformer of 6 urban public schools, and host of Automation Works and iSTEAM, which is Invention, Science, Technology, Engineering, Artistic Design, and Mathematics, Scavenger Hunt held at the North American International Auto Show. She has just released her newest book, Invisible Talent, Solving the Talent Shortage Without Outsourcing and Visas. Ms. Hill has a BA in Economics from University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, and an MBA from Jack Welch Management Institute at Strayer University. Let's give a huge welcome to Ms. Hill.
This event is evolved around the phone. As I said, a lot of times we don't talk about the phone as a robot, but everything is converging around the phone. The car, utility companies, you know, processes, everything is going around this mobile phone because it is your robot. But we think about the big robots, but we don't think about the little robot. Didn't play. We'll just skip on that. Automation Works is a scavenger hunt that is held at the North American International Auto Show. And how it actually developed is I went to one of my sponsors, who was Kamau, who puts these big welding robots in plants. And part of the reason why I went to them, because when you talk to a parent, not necessarily a child, parents don't want their kids to go work in a plant. And so I was having this conversation with a parent. When was the last time you've been in a plant? I don't know, 20, 30 years. I said, oh my God, that's changed so much. So Kamau has this working back in the 1800s, and they don't want their kids going to a plant because they don't know what it's about. That has water up to the lodge of the cars. And I'm thinking, my God, you're not going to have an event. But to show you how God does things, on 8 Mile and Telegraph, all electricity was gone except for the building we were in. So we had an event. People still showed up. And to watch parents' mouth hold open when they walk into this robotic wonder of a plant, because they are not accustomed to seeing what robotic wonders are. But the part that was interesting is that they were showing people how to use the facility. They had whipped out a little iPad. I said, how you do the robot? He goes, eventually we're going to be on the phone. But it showed you how the life has changed. So with our event, we had a scavenger hunt. So they had to do activities using some of the robots, some of them on an iPad, some of them on a cell phone, and they ran around to compete for money. So as we're walking out of the event, people had a good time. They learned a lot about robots and things of that sort. My executive says, where are we going next? Of course I'm on the spot. I got to think of something big. The only thing that came to me was the auto show. And I said, the auto show. Thinking, there's no way in hell I'm going to make the auto show, right? So I walk out. That was September 2014. I go and meet up with the auto show October 2014 and said, we would like to come to you. They said, we would love to have you. Very creative idea. And we'll skip to the video. Just go to the next slide.
That's right.
Okay. We would love to have you. Now, I'm going to tell you how I sold them on coming to the auto show. The internet. Okay, we'll go on.
Okay.
I sold them on the concept of business.
This is how you know you're dealing with a professional. You already anticipated that the PowerPoint thing happened.
Yeah.
You can keep on going.
Yeah. I sold them on the issue of Industry 4.0. How many people know what Industry 4.0 is? Oh, one person. Well, let me explain what each other is. Because you got to know. It's one of those scenarios where all the technology that we've ever heard about that's coming to fruition is coming to be. I have big robots in plants. I have simulations of how I'm going to train people in those plants. I have cell phones and iPads that are running these robots. And I have all of these things all coming together in the same spot. Now people go, that's not happening. Well, let me tell you, yeah, it is. Let me tell you how funny it is. 2 years ago, somebody hacked refrigerators in this country. 1.6 million refrigerators, people could not open their refrigerators. Because the computer chip and then somebody hacked them and shut them all down. You didn't even know your refrigerator had a computer chip. See, that's what I'm saying. So Industry 4.0, all these things are coming together and they're all technological wonders. Well, guess what? The key up is a computer chip. It can be mobile, it can be iPad, but it's a computer. So now, instead of you just going to your laptop or your PC, everything is a computer. Your car is a computer. Your refrigerator, your stove, your washing machine, your dryer, everything is now a computer, and they're all coming together in one place into what we call Industry 4.0. Now think about that for a minute. My refrigerator is a computer, and somebody could shut me out of my refrigerator. That could have some good applications. But that's where we're moving to in this country. Now, some of us call it the Industrial Internet of Things. Other people call it the Internet of Things. It's the same thing. Everything is coming together at the same place. Now, why is that important? It takes a whole different skill set when you go into your corporation. Because that means, guess what? Technology is changing so fast, what you learned yesterday is no longer in play today. What you learned today is obsolete again tomorrow. So your staff has to be flexible. When they come in today, whatever they're going to do today, they're not going to do tomorrow because it has changed in front of your eyes. Because everything is converging together. So what we decided, if we have a scavenger hunt, then every year they come in and do a hands-on activity, first of all, they don't know what they're going to do, so they learn on the fly. But they're competing for cash in the middle of 100,000 people at the North American International Auto Show. Can you imagine running around doing activities you don't know what you're getting into first, you're competing for cash against other families, and you're learning it on the fly. Well, you know what we learn? We learn two things. First of all, our young people are smarter than what we think they are. Much smarter. Number two, we also learn that guess what? We don't think about their parents being that smart, but even their non-degree parents are quite educated because they're educating these smart young people. And sometimes the schools do not keep up with our kids. So what we learn is that the children can come in here, no instructions, no manuals, no guides, give them some on the fly, and boom, it's done. That's what I call talent market. But we underestimate it, particularly when it comes to people of color. Well, I'm going to tell you what happened last year. We started with 50 people in the first event. Every year we've doubled it, 50, 125. Last year I had 462 people fly around the auto show. They would compete for $350 cash, first prize, $250 second prize, $150 third prize. Now, I, in my own event, I designed it, but I never really sat and walked behind a family. So this last time I walked behind a family, oh my God, I don't know how these people do this. This is a crazy event because they are literally on fly. They may have an assignment to go take a picture of a Hellcat engine. So they got to get through all of that thing, go find the Hellcat, open up that car, take a picture of the photo of the engine, and keep it moving. Or they may have an assignment where they have to guess the number of Skittles in a bottle. Problem is you can't open a bottle. So you got to figure it out. Either measure the cup, measure the spoon, or an hour former. Pick your choice. They don't have that much time to do this. But they're getting the answers right because they're very intelligent. And so when we say that they're the invisible talent market, and we kind of discovered them and their parents. Because sometimes we forget about their parents. May not have a degree, may not even have a certificate, but on the fly, they're quite bright. Now, oops, can you flip the movies back a bit? These are the things that are changing our world. We talk about self-driving cars, wonderful, but that's not really where we're going. We're going to self-driving trucks. Hard to find a truck driver for those companies who have logistics. So if I got a truck that has no driver, it can move a lot of things faster. I don't have to worry about people. AI, Jill Watson's a teacher. Here today, that's not coming, it's already here. 3D prototyping, already here. Locomotives make cars from boom, 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 done. It's here already. Robots, and we already talked about that in class, but this is my favorite, an air fulfillment center. Can you imagine a warehouse in the sky? My product in the sky, put a little X on the ground, and boom, drone comes and delivers it to me in my backyard. It's coming. It's here. And then data centers everywhere, they're all over the place. Because we live and thrive on data. All of that is technology. All of that is science. That is where we're going. But what has to happen is we have to make our talent market fit that. And that's where we struggle. These are all the jobs, I'm sure you guys agree with me, that we are having. But the one thing that I thought was interesting that I never heard anybody talk about is the data analyst. Who manages all that data? Have you ever noticed you sit in front of Hulu and all of a sudden something you had typed into your computer is now showing you an ad? Ever thought about that? Now, your ad is not the same as your ad. But you're watching the same TV show online, right? Isn't that data? Kind of very important then, because I can market to you, like lay up being a lot of pharmaceutical ads up, but maybe I need to do something, right? kind of scary. But at the core of all this technology is math. Now, I'm going to tell you how we got into automation works, because I realized at the core of all this technology is math. And when you go into a corporation, the first thing they do is they screen you for math. And guess who gets screened out? People of color. I can bet my life on it. You know why? Because in this country, most of them didn't have algebra.
Yes.
Am I right? Yes. And in 2011, the actual state of Michigan's graduation requirements finally required algebra to graduate. But up until 2007, the bulk of your people in the state of Michigan did not have an algebra class. Now, for most of us, that's hard to believe, because I bet you the bulk of the people in this classroom were on the college prep track, right? So you all had algebra. But the rest of the population had business math, blueprinting, construction math, personal finance. Have never seen algebra. It is a foreign language to them. Had never seen geometry, and most of them had never seen chemistry or physics. So when we go to our companies and we screen them out, it's not that they don't really know, they've never seen, because it wasn't required. if you weren't on the college prep track. Which means the 20% of the population who was college prep got that, but the other 80% didn't. Think about that for a minute. That's deep. Then on top of that, you got vocabulary, which is what most standardized exams is. It's not really computation, it's vocabulary. They didn't get that either. So when they look at your exam, it's foreign and Greek to them. Next slide. The bulk of the women, the bulk of the people who are afraid of math are women. They ask us why we don't go into science, technology, engineering, math, because they're afraid of it, because when they were in their classes, they told you you wasn't good at it. Am I right, women? My mother told me I don't care about what they said, but I said you're good at it. Let's make it happen. But that's the reality of life. So our program all revolves around math. Why we grasp it with technology because it's fun, but at the core of it is you got to get over the math. And so what? Next slide, please. Because what ends up happening, we don't talk about it out loud. People of color are bodily and kinesthetic learners. They learn with their hands. It makes them naturally suited for skilled trades. We don't want to talk about slavery, but in slavery we did skilled trades. In the Industrial Revolution we did skilled trades. We did things with our hands. We are naturally suited to that. So our event does everything with the hands. For the first time, I had a young person say to me, I get it. I said, what you get? He said, that thing we just did with a Skittle, that's a standardized exam question. I said, you're right, baby. It's just what you're doing. You're right. But what we're trying to do is equip your hand to teach you how do you master an exam. Because if you see it, you touch it, you feel it, you know the computation means nothing. It's easy. Next. This is who we serve. I put the ages of the parents up there. Because that's who we serve. Even though we're getting to the kid, we don't really serve the kid. Our job is to serve the parent. Because if I serve the parent, I have the child. Mm-hmm. But I got to get the parent. A month before the event, I'm panicking because I got 1,800 people registered for 250 slots. Mm-hmm. So I got to go through and pick who I want to come. Very traumatic to me, right? Never will do that again. I put the invite out 2 weeks before the event. Some last year was like a week and a half because I don't want to have to be there. And then we start working towards Europe. But here's what I want people to see. This is the results. You have schools 200% in math, 300% in math, and so on and so on and so on. It works. It works. And so what we're on a mantra now is to get corporations to say, let's look at how do we bring hands-on math into our corporation as a recruiting tool. Because the talent is out there, is how do you manipulate them and get them prepared for what you're doing. And my thing is, it's doable. And so we're on a mantra to expand our event from just events. Tools of the industry. So whether it's a robot, if you're construction, it could be a caliper, you're doing machine. At community college, they're manufacturing technicians, and to watch parents on a CNC machine, because they've never seen one before. And then turn around and make that same keychain on a CAD with a 3D printer, which is amazing. Because they had never done it. Next. And then I wanted to have a broader discussion. Next week I come out with my newest book called Invisible Talent Market that talks about blacks being very well suited, particularly for technology, very well suited for skilled trades, but invisible a lot of yes, ma'am.
I do want to say I did have the pleasure of volunteering with you last year. I was really impressed.
Thank you.
Totally. I was blown away. I wanted to stop volunteering. participate. Y'all was between the laws when we came.
Yes, I remember your face. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
I'm a college advisor at a high school.
Okay.
And I'm thinking about some of my students. I'm in Fort Huron, though. I'm a college advisor at Fort Huron Northern, and a lot of my students have either never been to Detroit. I have a massive fear of coming to Detroit from watching news too much.
Okay.
But I just would love for my students to participate in something like this. So do you focus on just Detroit Public School, or do you, how do you get this out that way, and maybe I can get my principal on
board? Well, actually, we get 7 counties of kids.
Okay.
7 different counties. Which is ironic that most of them are people of color. I couldn't tell you how we got to it. All we ask for is that if you do, to register them all in advance, and I'll give you my card,
okay,
and bring them by the busload. There's no fee for the event. They go into the auto show because most of the exhibits are served as our activities.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's for the whole family. So don't just look at the student. We say you have to have with your parents.
Okay.
We don't accept students without adults.
Okay.
And there's a reason for that.
No,
because I'm trying to educate adults.
No, that is very impactful because they like to ride on the staff coattails if they know that I'm going to be there.
Okay.
Oh, Miss Cece's coming. So knowing that is a must. Thank you.
But we will have to have your position going from 462, and I can tell you for January 2018, we're going to try to get 1,000.
Okay.
That's a double.
Yes.
That's a double.
Thank you.
So given all of this exposure to the parents and to the families from a metrics perspective, are you following them to see if this is leading them into STEM-related opportunities?
I am, and I have to tell you, we have the most interesting story. My most interesting story, and it actually brings me to tears, is a little protege parent who worked for my camp. I had a camp at Harbor Woods called Invention Adventure. And she came and worked for me for 2 summers as an intern. She was giving her associates, and it was taking her forever. And so one of our coaches had said, let's skip some of the classes for the associates, and you go straight to New England, Dearborn. Well, she graduated, and unfortunately, she couldn't find a job where she wanted to go. She wanted to go into innovation. She's now over as a project innovation administrator at Johns Hopkins University, where she's responsible. But the part that's comical about it, when she went out to God, a little high, which is what I tried to tell her. But she was stuck on that figure. So I said, why don't you go work for as a secretary in the division you want to go work for? So she goes and she works for as a secretary. But you do more than what they ask you to do. You volunteer or whatever. So she had recently just got promoted to this position where she makes $62,000. She's only 2.5 years out of college. So we're having those successes. But is it a challenge? Baby, it's a challenge. I'm going to tell you what's our challenge. We don't have enough money. Our struggle is cash. Because when you're taking a parent who's been poor and trying to bridge them upward, you have to hold their hand.
Mm-hmm.
It's a baby. It's baby steps. But once you get the baby, did not go beyond high school. But the next 3, the second one, he's on his way as a freshman to be an architect, and the next 2 will do the same. But the key was changing the parent.
That's right.
Yeah. So 3 out of 4 to me ain't bad.
Wow.
It's not bad. And those are the stories that we have that we change by, if we work with the parent, by get the parent, which is where I struggle, I got the children. But I have to use the children and cash to get to the parent. And that's what we do. So our struggle is always money. We never have enough. To the point sometimes I don't pay myself enough because I'm trying to put it in the programming to make the programming tight so that you can always say it works well. It works well. But yes, we do have lots of those stories in schools by schools. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
So what is the age range, number 1, and then is it only for schools and other outside organizations or churches?
Outside organizations can participate. Churches, most of our kids are coming to community groups. We do have a lot of schools that come by the busloads. But our average teenager that the parent orchestrates are teens, 7th through 12th grade. Now, that doesn't mean that we exclude any other kids, because what we found, we have some kids who are very, very bright at 10, 11, 12.
Okay.
And if their parents come, but we ask them to call us and let us know, because it's not really made for little kids. If you know anything about the last day of the auto show, there are 100,000 people there that day. It is like mass chaos. And so one of the reasons why we limit to teens, because you're weaving through this 100,000 people, and it is mass chaos. And you're doing it in a hurry with the mobile app, because you have to do assignments, you're taking photos of the assignments, and then you rush to the next thing. And we've just found kids that are younger than 10.
Uplift.org.
You can always go there and you can always reach me there, but I'm going to put the cards on the table.
Thank you. Okay, so for those of you who don't know me, I'm Carrie Buffington. I'm the Business Development Manager for the Detroit Women of Color Conference. We want to thank you all so much for coming today, number one. Number two, I just want to go around the room really quickly and have everyone stand and introduce themselves and where they're from. And we'll start real quickly on this course.
Hi, my name is Lynn Sheener, and I work for Fiat Chrysler, and I'm part of the diversity and inclusion team.
Hi.
Hello.
I'm Kelly Cleaver. I work for a nonprofit called Life and Models. We work in a different Detroit neighborhood, and we are focusing on school education.
Oh, you gotta speak up.
Oh, sorry. Yes.
Also with General Motors, Ken Barrett, and the Chief Diversity Officer.
Ken is a member of this conference.
Good afternoon. Brandon Price. I'm a development executive for the Boy Scouts of America. I'm actually over the Exploring program. And this year,
in our STEM activities, we call them STEM adventures. And we just did a big one in Shelley, Good Earth, and we had 1,000 scouts there. So.
I'm Brenda Perryman. I'm a retired educator, 39 years. And for 7 years, I've been doing a couple of television shows on WHPR. We have a good viewership. It includes England too, because I get gifts from England all the time. So I'm just happy to be here and want to help give them as much exposure as possible for the conference. And we appreciate it. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Robin Kinney. I'm the founder and president of Motor City Woman, which is a 24/7 internet radio station featuring an all-women-led lineup of show hosts, and we're also working to increase the number of women in the audio engineering fields.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Shonda Lewis, co-founder of the Allen Lewis Agency, sitting across from my dear business partner and bestie. And we're representing a client looking for opportunities to best leverage the conference. Nice to see you all.
Good afternoon. My name is Sean Rouse. I am the Information Technology Manager for New St. Paul Head Start, and I'm also president and founder of the Detroit HBCU Network.
Hi, I'm Olivia Ramsey, and I'm a sophomore at Cornell Northern, and I just was invited by my college advisor, Cece.
My name is Cece Sumter. I'm the college advisor at Port Huron Northern High School, and I just recently started my own nonprofit called Crowns for Little Brown Girls. It's dedicated to spreading positive messaging to all little girls of color. So I'm really excited, and Carrie invited me, so thank you so much for allowing me to come and bring my students in.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Marcus Johnson, account manager for the Detroit region at Aerotech. I'm also one of the members of our marketplace division for diversity and inclusion, trying to assist some of our companies with retaining and obtaining diverse clientele and employment.
Hi everyone, Nader Khan, also an account manager with Aerotech. I handle the Metro Detroit area for design and engineering. Thanks.
Hi everyone, I'm Amber J. Rowe. I'm also with Aerotech. I'm our customer support supervisor, and I'm with our diversity inclusion group. So thanks for having me.
Thank you, Aerotech. It's been a long time.
Hello, my name is Larissa York, and I'm an educator in Detroit. Thanks for having me. This was lovely.
Good afternoon. My name is Etta Garth. I'm administrator for Detroit Public Schools. And last year, I had the pleasure of taking my whole school, which is in Southwest Detroit, over to the STEM conference. And Carrie Buffington is my bestie. Yeah.
Good afternoon. I am Fayette Garth Banks. I'm formerly with the Greening of Detroit. Worked with DPS and their field coordinator, but presently I am representing Techno Museum 3000 East Grand Boulevard.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Trina Scott, and I lead our diversity and inclusion efforts at Quicken Loans, so I'm happy to be here. Thank you, Monica.
From the inner city of Detroit through college, offering them $18,000 in scholarship money if they complete our four-year program. What's so unique about our program is that we house six girls from the inner city. We provide everything for them. We partner with their parents to help get them through college. So I'm really excited about that, and I'm excited to bring some of our young people to the program. So thank you.
My name is Tamika Webb. I am a business analyst in our technology team at Quicken Loans.
Right. Good afternoon. My name is Bethany Collins. I'm an inspiring social entrepreneur, but I work in the nonprofit sector, and I work for the Community Foundation for your Clinton.
name is Leslie Mitchell with Rutherford & Associates, and we partner with CCG in making all this happen with you and for you. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Rachel Eubanks. I'm a commissioner with the Michigan Public Service Commission. If you're not familiar with us, we're the regulatory agency that ensures that customers in our state have access to safe, reliable, and affordable energy and telecommunication services. So in other words, we regulate DTE and we don't always necessarily see eye to eye, but certainly one of the things that we agree on as a state is the importance of really, you know, improving our talent pipeline in the state, in particular as it relates to supply and workforce diversity. So this is actually my first meeting here. Thank you very much for the invitation, and I'm looking forward to becoming more involved.
Thank you. We really appreciate you coming today with us. It means a lot, and we look forward to your ongoing participation. Thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Most important, CCG wanted.
Participated, and I think sometimes we've told the story. There's the information here, there's lots of ways to engage with us. But we thought it might be important to really listen to some of the thought leaders in the community and ask them to come forth. And I have to tell you, that was absolutely a fantastic. Internet 4.0, what I call the industrial internet on one hand and the internet of all things, one of the driving pieces that's a top priority for us at Career Communications Group. It will transform, and it is transforming society and the world as we see, as we sit here. And we're fighting this issue on a lot of different levels. What the Chinese are doing is not what we're doing and what the Germans are doing. Everybody's coming up with their own system. So leadership over the world will really decide where we are. And if we don't have this talent, and Ken knows this, and he's been so supportive of me over the years in the company. If we don't have the talent here, we will be behind in the United States. We will give up our global leadership. This is very important, particularly important for women and underrepresented groups in science and technology. Not just Indians, Blacks, Hispanics. Underrepresented is, you go right out where I went to Cornell, you go right over to Scranton, Pennsylvania. There's a whole lot of people that don't look like anybody in this room who are underrepresented in science and technology. So we can't forget anybody that's here. So talking about technology, when I asked last month, should we do this? And I think we took a vote, right, Jane? And everybody said, yeah, we think it's a great idea. I want to thank Carrie for her hard work in making this happen and pulling it together. This is an unbelievable crowd. This is not a seat available. And so that you know, we're going to bring in thought leaders, we thought thought we would just continue with a little experiment and reach out to our Facebook friends, about 15,000 women who are on our Facebook fan page. As we sat here, nearly 400 people were logged in on Facebook watching what happened here. Plus, we had a GoToMeeting webinar going, and I don't have those numbers yet. So imagine what this is going to look like next month. Thank all of you. I really want to thank you all. We want to be respectful of your time. I really like to thank even more the General Motors Corporation that's really been there. Ken has really been there, and we're really happy. We are here, and we're here to be part of the community and to be supportive. So thank you again. And I'm going to turn it back over to Mike.
I have to say that in this case, not in all cases, but in this case, that's really true of Dr. Tyrone J. Warner. He's been talking about what we were calling the digital divide and underrepresented minorities being left behind before we even coined the word STEM and diversity. And I mean, it's been like 30, 40 years ago that this vision that he had began growing and developing. And so he stayed the course. He stayed the course when a lot of folks sort of came in and faded out and dropped off. And it's really been an honor and a pleasure to see it grow and to see people come together and companies come together and support not just a conference, but an initiative that has continued to grow and see people connect and to lift up individuals and to change lives. And that's really what this is about. We try to think of this as more than once a year conference. We like to think of it as a life-changing experience, and your participation is really what makes this happen. So I'd like to thank you again for being here. I think we have still some few minutes if you want to spend some time networking, enjoy some dessert. There's materials here for you. If you're not signed up, if you're not signed in, please sign in. If you have your valet tickets, for parking, you want to give them to Karen. Karen will get them validated for you, so you can get your card.
I hope everybody valeted at Marriott.
Thanks again for coming.
Thank you, everybody.